How many of you think you're living an impressive life? Are you living an impressive life? Are you impressing other people? Kind of a dangerous game to play to try to impress other people, isn't it? You can sometimes do it. You can sometimes get away with a little bit, but sometimes you can crash and burn. You know, the disciples had a little issue with trying to impress one another. There's a story found in Mark chapter 10? 10:35. Mark 10:35, I think it is. It was near the end of Jesus' ministry. And it says James and John, that's a little loud. It says James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him saying, "Teacher, we want you to do for us a favor." And he said to them, "What do you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us that we may sit one on your right hand and the other on your left in your glory." Now think about what they were asking. First of all, in Jesus' ministry so far, he had never evidenced any kind of power over anybody, had he? Now, he had evidenced some power in miracles, but they were always used to help somebody. From his first miracle to his last, his miracles were about helping somebody, except for that one queer one with the olive tree or fig tree. All the rest were miracles to help somebody. And none of them were to exercise his power or authority over anybody. And here come these two guys, and they say, "Here's what we want. Our favor that we're asking is that you would make us co-rulers, co-regents with you, right and left hand, when you come into your glory." So it's weird on one sense that they didn't know Jesus' ministry even after 3 years of being with him. They didn't have a clue that his was a ministry of gentleness and not a ministry of power. But the second really interesting thing about it is, how in the world could they ask that in front of 10 other people who had also been following Jesus just as long as they had? It's really, really rude, isn't it? You know, you walk up and say, "I know you're going to be going away soon and I'd like your job," you know, right in front of all your coworkers, right? It's really, really rude. And so they make this rude deal. They want to be head and shoulders. Do you not think that they already felt that they were going to be leaders in the new kingdom? Well, surely they were his disciples. They were his students. They felt that when he came in power and he ruled over the Romans like the Romans had ruled over them, that they would easily be the persons who would be in his cabinet. But they weren't just asking for that. They were asking that they'd be number one and two in his cabinet. We want to be the top dogs. And we have a terrible, terrible natural tendency to want to impress other people. That is never more so true. Well, it has historically never been more so true than when you have a party. Several years ago, one of Mary Ellen's very dear friends' husband called us and said, "My wife is turning 50 years old and I'm no good at parties. Would you do it for me?" I think he knew not what he asked. We had a big house and we had a nice big yard. He said, "We expect about 50, 70 showed up. Planning a party for 50 people. Anybody ever done that? It's a kind of a big event. I mean, that's not something you throw together on a Tuesday afternoon, you know. There was live music, and of course, Mary Ellen doesn't cook meat. And we don't cook meat in any of Mary Ellen's pans. So these people were not Seventh-day Adventists. They were meat eaters. And so we were going to do chicken fajitas for 70. And so we had to buy a grill. And we bought a grill and we cooked fajitas for 70 people. I mean, we had a beautiful spread. Mary Ellen reminded me after first service that the guest of honor was 2 hours late. I had forgotten about that part. We cleaned that house. I mean, we cleaned the house. We bought two tented pavilions for the backyard. We borrowed tables so that we could run out a long line of tables to seat 50 or 60 people all across the lawn under the pecan trees. It was magnificent. I think we impressed some people. You know, if we live our life to impress people, we have the real, very real, serious danger of winding up having lived our life in a way that was not satisfactory to ourselves. Even to ourselves. If we live our life to impress other people, we will live to other people's expectations and not to our own. And that's the greatest danger, you know, because as a people, we have a natural tendency to want to please other people, to be honored by other people. And that's exactly what the disciples did here. And Jesus said, "You do not know what you ask. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, to be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" And they said, "We are able." And Jesus said, "Well, you will indeed drink the cup that I drink and be baptized with my baptism. But you to sit on the right and left of my throne is not mine to give. It is those to whom it is prepared." And when the 10 heard it, they began to be greatly displeased with James and John. And so he talks about leadership and rulership. But my question is, what is it that you feel about whether or not your life is impressive to others? Now, there's two ways of being impressive to others. You know, one is to have the American dream lifestyle, the really shiny new car, the really big house, right? And then all of the trappings that go with that. Now, you can impress other people that way, but there are a lot of people who don't see that as within their scope, and so they impress people the other way. They say, "Well, you know, I just drive an old jalopy." That's just another way of impressing people, isn't it? I would never spend that kind of money on a car. You know, I would never do that. I just can't. And then therefore, and earlier I said it was the second, a party is the second most popular way to impress other people. You see, because something else is interposed. It's called Facebook. Has anybody noticed that on Facebook there are all these people trying to impress you? Oh my goodness, and it's so blatant. They're not even careful about it. I mean, they start bragging on there as if, you know, you would never brag like that in person, would you? These people show pictures of themselves and they're doing these amazing things and, oh, you know, I just ran X number of, you know, 1,000 miles or whatever it was. And you go, really? Really? No one would ever do that in person. Hey, come here. Let me tell you something. I just ran 15 miles. And you'd go, wow, cool, I guess. Right? So our real scripture today comes from John chapter 13. John chapter 13 and verse 6. And you'll remember this is the story of the Last Supper. And Jesus has got his disciples all together. And they're all getting ready now. And they're all ready to eat except for one little detail. They haven't had their feet washed. Now, scholars disagree and argue about the speculation as to the order of the foot washing. Whose feet did he wash first? This text said, and when he came to, well, it said he, in verse 5, it said he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with a towel which was girded. And when he came to Simon Peter, so a lot of scholars believe that Judas was first and he just took it and didn't say anything because he was under a lot of pressure at that time. And that Peter was second, and Peter voiced the concerns that all of the disciples would have felt. There were two things that were really, really wrong about this. And the first thing that was really, really wrong about this was that the master was on his knees washing people's feet. Absolutely unacceptable, absolutely unheard of, okay? Donnie loves to tell the story of going to South Africa to give evangelistic series. He says when he got off the airplane, from the time he got off the airplane until he got back on the airplane, those people held him in such honor and esteem that he was only able to carry his own Bible, and only then if it was a short distance. His bags, everything that he had was carried by other people. They came and they honored him by not letting him carry anything. Now, in this country, you know, not quite so much like that. I've been known to set up a table and a chair here. So the bottom line is that, you know, different cultures. And in this culture, our friend Peter and the gang would never have accepted the master getting down on his knees and washing feet. So that was number one. And we're clear on that. We study that from time to time. The other thing that was really weird about this is that the master was essentially not only indicting them for not doing this themselves, But he's also indicting them for having dirty feet. I mean, if you think about it, remember when you were a kid and your mother would go, remember that? A little spit bath? Have you ever had a spit bath? And she licks your, then she wipes your face off with it? Nobody had that happen? Only my mother did that. Okay, Sam's mother did that. Thank you, Sam. Grandmother. And so when you do that, you're saying you got something there that you need cleaned off. And Peter is horrified. He says, no. You are disgracing me in front of all these people by claiming that I'm dirty. And that is exactly the problem of trying to live our lives to impress others. Because it will come back to hurt us. It will come back to destroy us, because this living life to impress others cannot succeed, and it can always take us to a place that we did not desire to go. The next question that we have to ask is, are you living a life that you're satisfied with? Are you satisfied with your life? First, we talked about direction. Are you going in a direction that other people are declaring? And the second question is, are you getting any movement going? Are you moving at all? There was an interesting project came out a few years ago, and it asked people to describe their life in 6 words or less. Now, that's not very many words, is it? Some of the answers that they got was, one tooth, one cavity, life is cruel. That's 7 words, isn't it? Savior complex makes for many disappointments. Cursed with cancer, blessed with friends. That was a 9-year-old boy who had cancer. The psychic said I'd be richer. There's a 5-word one that said, one long train to darkness. It's kind of depressing, isn't it? Tombstone won't say had health insurance. Not a good Christian, but trying. Thought I would have more impact. People, what would you put if you had to declare your life in 6 words? It's hard because you have to distill it to the very, very essence, isn't it? And here's the problem that we have. We have a problem. We have even a term in this country called couch potato. And the problem with our lives is many of us are going in the wrong direction, but many of us also are not going in any direction. And there's a, I don't know anybody familiar with the second law of thermodynamics. It's about entropy. Does everybody know what entropy is? It's sort of synonymous with chaos, disorder. All of our lives are headed toward entropy or chaos in the absence of something else. The second law of thermodynamics, I thought that there was one declaration of the second law of thermodynamics. I was wrong. I talked to Dr. Kruger about it. I was really wrong after talking to Dr. Kruger about it. But the second law of thermodynamics says, in essence, that any system that is left to itself will ultimately deteriorate and decay into chaos. Now, what's really interesting about that, I mean, if you go back in time and you look at that, that absolutely is a problem with the creation of the universe. Everybody clear on that, right? Because out of nothing came something, and even the scientists agree that out of nothing came something, and they call it the Big Bang, and that would be the opposite of the second law of thermodynamics. So I don't know where that comes from, but wherever you are, you get to Earth, and we have a system that is somewhat closed, and it should be devolving to entropy, and it's not. Life is exploding. And you look at that, and you wonder how that works, and you go a step further, and you say, wait a minute. Last week, I was sitting right here, and somebody in the other church that meets here on Sunday asked a fascinating question. He said, what would our world be like today if Jesus had not appeared 2,000 years ago? You remember the history. The nation of Israel had decayed and decayed and decayed and had fallen into entropy. And what happened next was they were taken into captivity. Ultimate captivity occurred over three or four different powers until finally Rome was in charge. And Rome was a society in decline as well, wasn't it? And then Jesus came and everything changed. Suddenly, there was a motivation for people to act differently. And they began to act differently, some out of sincere motives and some out of insincere, but it changed everything. Today, here now, if it weren't for the Christian movement founded by Jesus, do you think we would have ever gotten past slavery? Do you think the New World would ever have been discovered? Do you think we would have ever gotten past the other ills, moral ills that the world had created? And I say no. Because it was Christians at the vanguard of every one of those civil rights movements. It was Christians who worked against slavery. It was Christians who worked against the after effects of slavery. It was Christians who worked against for equality. And for all these reasons, we would live in a very entropic world but for the coming of Jesus. So how about your life? We have a problem with entropy. And, you know, couch potato is just the illustration of it. There's a fellow who writes on this subject named Max Dupree, and he says that when we see these signs in our lives, we can know that entropy is upon us. Number one, a tendency towards superficiality. You see that in this world today? Number two, unresolved tension in relationships. Three, no longer having time for celebration and ritual. Number four, confusing heroes with celebrities. Number five, a loss of gratitude. And number six, a vague, chronic sense of guilt. These are what happens when we let our lives devolve into what our lives would ordinarily be without the regenerating power of God. Now, Jesus comes to these boys and he says, I'm going to wash your feet. And Peter says, no way are you washing my feet. No way are you washing my feet. And Jesus said, if I don't wash your feet, you have no part with me. You're not one of my disciples. You can't eat at my party anymore. And Peter responds, well, then wash me all over. Heads, hands, everything. Give me a bath. And Jesus said, no, you are all clean, but your feet. Now, that's a really interesting statement. Clearly, it has some reference to baptism. But it's also somewhat confusing. And the reference has to do with this event of foot washing. It would never be acceptable in their culture to let the teacher wash your feet. And he was asking them to do something outside of the ordinary. And today, Jesus is asking you to do something outside the ordinary. Sometimes at New Year's, we have a tendency to want to make a whole bunch of resolutions. I'm going to fix this, and I'm going to fix that, and I'm going to fix that, and I'm going to fix this, and I'm going to do this, and I'm never going to do that again, and I'm never going to do this again, and I'm going to do that, and I'm going to do that. And how does that end? Perfect failure every time. I mean, it's doomed. When you started, it's doomed, because what you have done is set up expectations so great that only by miracle could any one of those be done. And we do it all the time. It's like saying, I think I'll build the Hoover Dam tomorrow. But I'm not going to call the concrete company today. I'll wait till tomorrow to do that. And you dial up the concrete company in the morning and you say, I need 150 million cubic yards of concrete. And they say, today? And you say, well, in the next day or two. And they say, no. And that's exactly what we do to ourselves with our New Year's resolutions. So here's what I'm going to suggest to you. The third question that we have to ask, number one, are we going the right direction? Number two, are we going at all? And the third question is, are you living a life? Is your life in any way within God's plan for you? And so that would be direction and movement, wouldn't it? And the question is, how do we get the movement? A lot of research has been done lately on habits. And the research indicates that everything we do is a habit. And I'm looking at Eddie, and I'm glad you're here today, Eddie and Monique. And we're glad you're all here because you're perfect examples of what happens when you fix your habits. Anybody shook Eddie's hand lately? Can I bug you to come up here, Eddie, please? Will you come up for me? Okay, so this is my friend Eddie, and you'll see in a minute why I didn't ask his wife to come up. Okay, so this is Eddie, and if Eddie went to work right now and started working out in this shirt, he could rip this shirt open, okay? Because he's not pumped up right now. An hour of pumping and this shirt will rip, yeah? Yeah, it's gonna rip right here, hopefully, yeah. See, now, Eddie wasn't born with these, okay? And his legs are just as big. Well, they're bigger, actually. So Eddie wasn't born with this. How did Eddie get this? Eddie got this the same way that anybody would have to get this. He did not buy a magic pill. He did not order it on Amazon. It is not the result simply of nutritional supplements. But if you look at this, and again, I apologize for it because he's not pumped up right now, but this is huge. My hands, and I've got big hands, barely reached around his relaxed bicep. Okay? I'm thinking 24 inches? No. Not quite?
18.
18, you think? I think 20. Okay. Thank you, Eddie. Eddie did not do this by magic. This was not a miracle. No, you're not going to come up. If I want the other example, James, I have it right here. This is the opposite example. What Eddie did, whether Eddie knows it or not, is that Eddie changed his habits from entropy to action. Now, here's what happens with habits. Habits all have three parts, and most everything we do is a habit. I want to thank Brother Dulman for sharing a book with me that explained all this, and it's very, very valuable. Habits have three parts. Habits have a trigger, habits have a routine, and habits have a payoff. Okay? Every habit is the same. It has all three of these parts. So, you're done with the dishes. You're done with whatever. You've changed into your house slippers. You've done everything that can't wait until tomorrow. And you sit down on the sofa, you reach for the remote control, and you become a couch potato. So the trigger is, I'm done with the things that I know I have to do that I can't put off until tomorrow. That's the trigger. The next part is the operation of the habit, and that is fiddling with the buttons on this machine so that beautiful color pictures appear before me and I laugh or whatever. That's the payoff. My feet are up, my feet feel good, I'm laughing. Eddie doesn't do that, see, because Eddie has a different routine. His trigger is, I finished everything I have to do today. Now it's time for me to lift some really heavy weights. It's time for me to test myself. It's time for me to prove that this weight is not going to be too heavy for me today. And he does that every day and ultimately looks like an Adonis. While the rest of us, well, our weight shifts to other areas. And the real issue is simply one of which habit did you create? Now, the good news is that God has not left us in a vacuum of knowing his will for our lives. He's given us his word. Now, here's the problem. We can only know wisps and gusts of wind and little puffs of smoke about his will if all we do is we exercise our habit to come to church once a week and listen to some guy talk. God is calling you to read his word yourself. Now, I'm thinking that not a New Year's resolution, because New Year's isn't for 4 days away. I'm thinking a new day resolution. And the new day resolution needs to not be, I'm going to read every word of the Bible 3 times this year. That's not it, okay? Because again, you're with Hoover's Dam and you don't have enough concrete yet. You have to start with something manageable. And how about this? How about this? Every morning, after I brush my teeth, I will at least open the Bible and read a word. Is that too much? Is that something you can do? Every morning after I brush my teeth, maybe for you it's before you brush your teeth. I don't know. If you can read scripture before you brush your teeth, good for you. Every morning, think of the trigger, see? Every morning when I brush my teeth, I will open God's word and I will read something, okay? Once you have developed that habit, God will multiply your power. God will reward your courage and your activity. I promise it. And he will transform your life, because you know, a little habit like reading scripture will change your life. If you're not reading your scripture daily, and if you decide that the trigger is your brushing of your teeth, or the trigger is the tying of your shoes, or the trigger is your taking a shower in the morning, whatever your trigger is that triggers you to open God's word, if you will open God's word and read just a little bit every day, your life will be transformed. Amen. Why do we pray on our knees? There's no really good reason. You know, the Bible writers prayed on their knees, but not like we do. You know how we pray on our knees. We go to our knees and we fold our hands, and we're fairly erect. When the Bible writers said they go to their knees, they fell flat on the ground. They went to their knees and then they put their face on the ground. So we don't do it like them. But why do we go to our knees? You say, that's a silly little thing. And I say, yes, it is a silly little thing. It was a silly little thing that Jesus demanded of Peter on penalty of being kicked out of his group, that he permit him to wash his feet. Why was that so important to Jesus? It was such a little thing. It was a little thing. Do you think Peter could have gotten through that meal with 30 feet? Of course he could. It had nothing to do with his feet. It had everything to do with his submission to a thing that Jesus asked him to do without asking questions, just doing it. And today he's calling on us to pray. Why do we pray on our knees? It's a silly thing. It's a silly thing. All it does is it tells our body and our mind and the angels and the demons and the Holy Spirit that we are submitting our life to God. It's a little thing. But it is so important that we sometimes go to our knees. We don't have to always pray on our knees, but sometimes we have to go to our knees. Why is it important that we pray for other people? That's a little thing. Do we really need to do that? Does he really mean it? He really does mean it. He means all of these things, and he's asking us to do them. Now, I'm not asking you to make a resolution that you're going to do all 7 of these things, okay? I'm asking you to do one of them, because all you need is one of them. And you need to start small enough that your faith in evidence will spawn better and bigger and greater blessings. Now, here's how you do it. Pick a trigger. Any trigger will do. You need to do a trigger you do every day. My wife's father was a great man, and he ran every non-Sabbath day of his life between 3 and 5 miles in the morning. He got up in the morning and he ran. Even when Parkinson's took away his ability to move his muscles, he went from walking to running to shuffling, because he had habituated himself to do it. Now, I have a less noble habit. I grew up in a house, you know, in 100 years ago, you got to understand the context here. In 100 years ago, in the northern United States, daily bathing was not the rule. Weekly bathing was the rule. Everybody with me on this? Okay, so don't look down on me, because I grew up in a house that believed in baths on Sunday nights. But when I was 12 or 13, I received a new trigger, and that is that I smelled bad. And I didn't just smell bad on Sundays. I smelled bad every day. And I realized that I had to do something about that. That trigger said, you've got to do something. And I noticed that we had a bathtub in the house, and it worked every day. And I developed a new habit. And that habit is every morning when you get up, I take a hot shower. I love hot showers in the morning. It's the only thing between me and looking like a troll. So I get up early in the morning and I take a hot shower. It doesn't matter what's going on. That's how I start the day. It's a habit. The trigger is I smell bad. The procedure is you wash all over, especially your oily hair. And the payoff is I don't smell bad anymore. That is a habit that I do every day. Now, again, it's not going to help me as much as my father-in-law's habit of running 3 to 5 miles, but it is a habit. And you folks all have lots of habits in your lives. I have lots of habits in my life. What I'm asking you to do is let God take control of some of these habits. Turn your triggers into behaviors that are faithful, God-centered, biblical behaviors like praying, like reading scripture, like writing epistles to one another, like contacting people, feeding the poor, taking care of people who are needing you right now, making telephone calls, texts and emails, and taking care of God's business here on earth. And I'm not asking you to do it all tomorrow. I'm not even asking you to do it all next year. I'm asking you to start something today. Tomorrow is too late. New Year's is far too late. That's 4 days away. If you'll come to our Agape Feast, I'm going to try to have for you a little journal so that you can start writing. Okay? I'm going to make up some journals. If you'll come on Wednesday night at 6, we will have a good time, I assure you. If you will accept not my challenge, God's challenge, if you will accept God's challenge, what did Jesus say? His first ministry call was turn and be baptized. Well, where does the turn come in? Oh, you say, it's all God's work. I'm just going to wait for him to create it in me. Right? Because that's what Paul said. It's all grace. Right? Not law, it's grace. It's all grace. Right? That's what Paul said. So let's read Paul, 1 Corinthians 9, verse 23. 1 Corinthians 9, 23. Here's Paul. Now this I do for the gospel's sake. That's the good news. That's the grace he's talking about, right? This I do for the gospel's sake, that I may be a partaker with you. Do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but one receives the prize? Remember, we're in grace, not works. Run in such a way that you may obtain it. Wait a minute. He told me to run? I thought that was the Holy Spirit's job. Run in a way that you may obtain it. And everyone who competes for the prize is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable crown. Therefore I run this, not with uncertainty. This is how I fight, not as one who beats the air, but I discipline my body. Some translations say I beat my body. Don't get confused about self-flagellation. That's not what that's about. He says, I discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should be disqualified. Now, this is the same guy that's talking about grace. So don't begin to think now he's talking about works. In the whole corpus of all of his writings, this is one section. But what he is saying is that we have to take a step. And it's the same thing Jesus said when he said, repent and be baptized. We have to take a step. We have to demonstrate the faith that only comes from God by grace. And that faith is to take action toward God. Jesus said, go ye therefore into all nations, teaching, preaching, baptizing, teaching them to what? Obey everything I have told you. Obey everything I have commanded you to do. Now, we have to start somewhere. This is the New Year's, my favorite holiday. Favorite holiday. It's a day of fresh beginnings. You know that you worship a God of fresh beginnings. Amen? You worship a God of do-overs. You worship a God of restarts. You worship a God of reboots, as you will in the newest language. Our God wants to give you a fresh chance. He says there is now no condemnation to those who are God's people. So there's no condemnation for anything we've done in the past. Forget about your failures. Forget about your history. Forget about all those times you made silly pronouncements that you were ever and never and always and gonna. And start fresh with God today. Today. Not any other day. Not on the 1st of January. Today. Pick one little habit to start today. A little habit that you know that God has called you to do. Because I'll tell you this, I know if you're anything like me, that over the course of 2014, that God has given you a few little reminders, hasn't he? He's given you a few little nudges. He's suggested to you things in your life that you needed to fix, things in your life that you needed to mold, things in your life that you needed to change and move. And he's made this clear in your heart and in your mind over the year of 2014. Now, today, what I want you to do is I want you to think about whether or not God has percolated one of those to the top of the list for you. Is there one that you know that God is telling you that you need to take up a new habit? And I'll tell you what, quitting old habits, I guess that's important, but I'm going to tell you something. I really believe that God will cure your old habits if you create better ones. Okay? So what I'm asking you to do is create better habits. And the habits that we know that God sponsors are Bible study and prayer. The habits that we know that God sponsors are doing good for others, being loving and caring. Now, today, here today, what I want to ask from you is that in a minute, we're going to pray. I'm not going to ask you to write on any cards today. New Year's resolution. No, it's not. I'm not going to ask you to write on any cards today. What I am going to ask you to do is I'm going to give you a moment of silence, and I want you to let the Holy Spirit speak to your heart about what is the one thing, the one practice, the one thing that would make the most difference in your life. If that's journaling, it might be journaling. If that is taking time every day just to focus on God and His Spirit in your heart, if it's reading, if it's praying, if it's studying, you know, studying and reading are two different things. Whatever that is that God is impressing upon you, then I want to pray a prayer of consecration on that thing. Okay? So let me pray, and I'm going to give you a pause, and I want you to let the Holy Spirit speak to you as to what is the habit that you are being called to create, not this year, not this month, not this week, this day, in God's kingdom. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we know that you have in store and in mind and in plan for us a different and better life than we're currently living. We thank you that you do not condemn us for where we have failed to follow you as you attempted to lead us. We ask for your forgiveness where we have actively rebelled from you. And now, as we listen with our hearts to your Spirit, we ask that you'd reveal to us the one thing that each of us is so desperately lacking that it will be the life changer that we've been looking for. We thank you for opening our hearts and our minds. As we continue to pray about this subject, we ask that you would not only bring to our minds these things that need changing, but hammer them to us so that we cannot escape your call. We give you permission to pursue us, to chase us, to hound us, to change us. We ask that your Spirit will give us the wisdom to know exactly how to introduce repentance, turning, and transformation in our life. And we also ask that you would give us the courage to continue to follow. Help us to create the habits of godliness and then change our hearts singly, one by one, moment by moment, that we might be like Paul and like Peter and like James, that we might be pioneers in faith. Change us now. We give you all the permission and we give you all the glory to change us now. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.